So I'll give you an outline. I'll talk about romance preservation as a path to happiness, because I believe that every one of us works for happiness. Some people get happiness in A, B, C, and we talk about what is happiness, how you can get happiness through the romance preservation. I'll tell you a little bit about my story, because I think that personal story is what really drives me to start thinking in a similar manner. And I'll talk about the challenges and possible solutions for both areas, especially in household sector, farming sector. And I'll talk about high-tech solutions for rural areas. This is something which people don't talk about. The moment they talk about rural areas or those solutions, they always talk about thinking. And I'll tell you that extremely sophisticated technology required in developing new ideas and technologies for rural areas. And finally, I'll talk about excellent brains for rural development. So happiness through innovation. All of us work to maximize our happiness. And after that, you know, after my talk, I would like to have a lot of interaction. I would like to have sharp questions, because I thrive on that. And I think it would be wonderful to remove your doubts and clarify something. Some people get happiness through fame and money. I'm going to talk today on a higher level, higher process. And that is creating something wonderful. Inventing, innovating, also gives happiness. And I'm sure all of you have seen this in your life. When you have done something wonderful, you have solved a very difficult problem, it gives you a tremendous high, the time vanishes, the time stops, and you are so engrossed in your thing that you do not know what happened. And if you continue this process, and which is a part of the yogic process, then you really develop a very powerful brain, which can attack any problem, anytime. Innovation is like yoga. Watch the goal, all the roadblocks and pinpricks become into concentration. When I went to the United States, I was teaching, I was a rising star in the University of Florida. And out of madness, I decided to come to rural India. This was a place, Paltan, where to make a phone call in 1981, I would hop on the bus, go 4 hours to Pune and make phone calls. Now that requires a tremendous amount of learning. There was a tremendous arrogance, an arrogance that I will change India. India did not change, India is a 10,000-year-old country. It changed me. And this is what I will tell you about. And I hope some of you have read my books. In fact, I have 2 books which I have read in the library. You are most welcome to read that. And also I have put my book on the innovations that we have done as a free book on the internet. In the hope, in the font hope, that you smart kids who are in the technology area should engage in rural development, in trying to bring in technology, in trying to do something wonderful. So this is when you have that junoon, and I call it as a junoon, that madness, and everything vanishes. My father told me that I was an idiot after going from the best school in Lucknow to IIT Kanpur, and at those times IIT Kanpur was the best IIT in the whole country, going to America, and then coming back to rural India. But I followed my heart. And this is the message I would like to give to you. If you follow the path, don't, you know, I was talking to someone. I said, what do you like to do? He said, I would like to do work in, you know. I said, come and join me. He says, I have to ask my parents. At the age of 29, you have to ask your parents. And something is really wrong. You have to follow your path. And if you feel that, yes, this is the right thing you want to do, then nothing is wrong. There will always be conflicts. When I came, when I told you that I came, there was nothing, flat piece of land. I had to build everything. But there was this junoon that I should utilize my knowledge, arrogance, that let me do something wonderful. I don't know whether anything wonderful was done, but at least it kept me happy and running. R&D means unfettered mind. Because I said to myself that I'm a PhD, I should be able to utilize my knowledge for developing technologies and unfettered mind. And if you are really too much bothered by the mosquitoes and the heat and etc., then that is not an unfettered mind. And Janoon provides you with this tremendous power to really get out of that. it is becomes, you know, a full-fledged passion. It's just like you need to do something. So all those things fixed back. To do something meaningful in one's life and give back to society brings great joy. This giving back to society was never my aim. Was never my mission. It was to do something wonderful in my life. And when the things started happening, when people started utilizing, then it gave a lot of satisfaction. Yes, something is useful somewhere. It is a romance thing. Because when you get into romance, when you really fall in love, then you won't think about anything else. Your parents may say something, your friends may say something, but you are very focused on the focus of your romantic things, and that is what is called romance. From IIT in 1974, I went to United States and came back in 1981. And I have written this in my book called 1970s America, an Indian student's journey. That book has been gone all over the world. The former ambassador of the United States read that book. He wrote a very long letter that it's a wonderful book. I think talking to the Library of Congress, etc. But this was my own journey, which I put it, and I hope you can read it and may provide some inspiration. Return to India because of arrogance will change India. India did not change, it changed. Challenges of working in rural Maharashtra. This is written in the new book, which is you must have read in the internet, on what different technologies you develop, what are the problems we face, how we solve it. And I think that's the real romance. Because in a very small setup, with very little resources, with very little funding, but if we have a good quality of thought, one can do a lot of wonderful things. All the time that people complain that I don't have this, I don't have that, is because we do not want to do anything. If you really want to do anything, after all, you should realize, because you are too old, you are young, that we send the man to the moon, Americans, without the computers. We had computers, a lot of the Saturn V rockets broke up, they collapsed, and so on and so forth. But the man was sent to the moon without the computers. So when you can, in fact, my professor, Dr. Anil K Rajvanshi, he got the NASA's highest award for the Saturn V rocket design. In fact, I have the great satisfaction of meeting Von Braun, the father of modern rocketry, who designed the Hitler's V2 engines. And the films that I saw, the discussions that I had, it was amazing what technology they developed without any very sophistication things. Just that they were at it. So one can do wonderful things without really recourse to technology helps, modern things help, but that should not be the cause. You should not like to do anything. You can do wonderful things. This book is freely available. Mantra for working in both environment in general. Develop a journey in your life. Whatever you want to do. That is the basis of pathology. If you focus on one path and continuously keep on focusing it, you develop a tremendous power of concentration. When you apply that concentration to anything, whether it is pursuing your girlfriend or boyfriend, whether you are solving a problem with technology, whether you are doing anything, that you get a tremendous amount of solutions. Because the power of concentration is what makes your brain with power. Janoon is a focus activity, needs to be cultivated from childhood. Janoon is helped by concentration, meditation, curiosity, and picking up interesting projects. Pick up any projects that you want. I've been talking to a lot of the students since morning. I tell them the problems exist around you. Start having a kitchen garden in your hostel. Do anything that requires solutions, and you will do a wonderful thing by focusing on a little longer term. If you get out of your mobile, if you get out of your internet, and start focusing, you will develop something very wonderful. Because you are so focused on your mobile, you react, and because of the reaction, you don't think and contemplate and reflect. So that's something that you will develop. Janoon helps avoid pressure from family and friends. And that I did in my life. greatly focused mind helps getting the right priorities of life, helps in becoming a teacher. And this is how I discovered spirituality. When I started living in rural India, because there were a lot of people, not a lot of people, but few people who were working in rural development in 1980s and 1970s. They were all working mostly by staying in big cities. They had villages, they used to go and visit. I said to myself when I came back that I should live in that place. Because I may not be living in a jhopadi, but the very act of my living there, when I see in a sensitive mind, then I will start looking for solutions. And that has helped a lot. And I think that is something which I would like to advise you. I'm not asking you to spend all your life. I did that for because of madness. But spend a year or 2 years in NGOs like us, and there's so many other NGOs. And then you will really learn about poverty. And when you learn about poverty, you will try to solve it because you are right mind. And that is the basis on which you can utilize your technology. Genesis of happiness. Tranquility and sustainability. This is genesis of happiness, focused mind. Giving back to society is also very really important. So what are the challenges in rural areas? What are the things that we are talking about these unsolved problems? Even 68 years after independence, almost 60% of our rural population, 100 million, have primitive lifestyle. How many of you are from rural areas? Have you lived in a hut? Would you like to live in a hut? Would you like to live in the way that you live? That is how the challenge starts. Can you make their life better so that you will live in that hut without too much of complaining? Sure, it will not be as good quality of life as in the IIT campus. But think about it. Because when you start thinking from those numbers, that is when the technology starts happening. That is when the new inventions start happening. And this is what we'll try to show you in a very limited manner, how we try to solve it. This is just scratching the surface, because the problems are so huge and they all require a great intervention through technology, through smart energy. Hardly any electricity. You know, I live in Western Maharashtra. Western Maharashtra is the most progressive part of Maharashtra, probably in India. We are supposed to have 24/7 electricity, etc. But within 5 to 10 kilometers of our small rural town, there are quite a number of huts which have never seen electricity. And I'm talking about Western Maharashtra. Look at the situation in UP, Bihar, Uttarakhand, in Odisha, where people do not have anything. We have the worst situation of malnourished population in the world. 30% of our population is malnourished. We have a lot of problems. And yet we want to send the man to the moon and the Mars. It is fine. But we should also look at the technological implications and try to see how we can solve and improve the quality of life. Rural poor in India are some of the most malnourished in the world. Need for rural restaurants, and I talk to you about that. 30% of the world's poorest people in India. What a shame. My father went to jail with Gandhi. He was the second string of leadership after Nehru and Patel. And I had a great satisfaction of meeting some of the who's who of India's independence movement and also the people who ran this country. And I used to always ask my father, what is the point of your going 2.5 years? Where have you got off from? Yet no answer. You felt very frustrated, as all of us are. But I think we can do it. We can do it by becoming great engineers, by building this country. Country is always built by engineers and farmers. And you are at the prime location, prime institute. So you should be involved in building this great country. Because some of you may go abroad, but a lot of you will stay here. And wouldn't you like to stay in a very nice country? Wouldn't you like to stay after? Tell me, if I give you a choice, how many of you like to go to America? I'm sure all of you. I used to ask myself a question that even if Gandhiji came today, and if I ask him, where would you like to go, he would immigrate to America. We have made this country so so on. But yet we have the power to make this again a great country. Not as conservative as America or Europe, but a very a country where we can live very nicely with a high quality. Modern technology has not touched their lives. Now I'll show you a very interesting thing. This is the graph. Do I have a anyway? This is a graph which shows the human development index. This human development index is a combination of so many things. The quality of education, the quality of work. This is a old timer. When we were students, this is what we had. So this is the quality, basically a quality of life. And here is the energy, and there is a relationship. As you can see, it's a very skewed relationship. And if you have 0.8, you have a quality of life, which is like a European quality of life of 1978, which is a very decent quality of life. But you were too young. I have seen that, and it was a very decent quality of life. And that can happen in certain amount of energy. Today, the United States, Canada, all these countries, they are very consumptive. And they spend a huge amount of energy. United States consumes around 335 billion calories. This is a number. Just look at the ratio. India an average is 35, and in rural India it is 3 to 4. Look at the quality. And you know this is all according to the present rate of conversion of energy into useful product. If we become more energy efficient, then this will become even better. So what we are aiming at, so we need a minimum of 50 gigajoules per person per year, which will give us an index of 0.8 or 0.82. And this is should be the aim of all our technological development. How we utilize the locally available resources into useful end product by giving so much energy. And rural areas have a lot of energy. They have biomass, they have sun, etc. But what is required? Technological innovation. Because today, all the energies that we have are mostly petrol, coal, etc., which are in the urban areas, and we are trying to transfer that model into rural areas, which is not very innovative and not very efficient. So this is a challenge for the engineers that we do. So, provision of increased energy from local resources are challenges for engineers. So, I am giving you this as a graph to tell you where we can start. So what should be, before I go into the specifics, I'll tell you a little philosophy of strategy for rural development. Now this is a very interesting graph. This is a size of a system with time and increasing complexity. We are a product of dinosaurs. This is the natural way of evolution, that when you evolve, either your design, either anything that you do, there is an exuberance of development. Because you are not sure of how your technology will evolve, so you have these very big systems. Because the big systems allow you to maneuver things. Dinosaurs came in the early stages of our evolution, then suddenly the nature found out that they were very, very inefficient machines. They used to consume huge amount of material, the waste was brain, and it took corrective action. For whatever reason, the dinosaurs vanished, and then came out other forms of life, small, and we humans are an outcome of that process. We are very compact, very efficient, and very complex. And all our technologies are based upon that. Have you seen the first mobile phone? Have you looked at it in the internet? Have you looked at how it was formed? Right. It was this big, weighed 2.5 kilograms. You could make 2 calls because it was directly connected to the Iridium satellite. And today if I look at your mobile phone, I can't even see because it's a small thing here. All our technologies follow the same evolution process. I'm giving you this example, I'm giving you this philosophy because this is what is required when we look at the innovation, when we look at the rural innovation. This is what we are looking at. How we utilize all the forces that exist, because that is how nature evolves. It evolves by taking all the forces around it into equilibrium and then comes to the nature. It does not plan, only humans plan. And if the nature starts planning, Probably if you get so confused, she will stop doing and stop the work. Hallmark of evolution is size reduction, increased efficiency, room temperature. In fact, all our technologies are basically at a very high temperature. All the electricity that we produce is at a very high temperature. We burn fuel, we burn fuel in the combustion engine, we burn fuel in everything, turbines, etc. A very high temperature, and then we convert it into useful gas. Have you seen in nature anything working at 1000 degrees Celsius? Everything that works in nature is at 1000 degrees. The whole basis of convert of mechanical energy in nature are the muscles. They convert the chemical energy into mechanical energy directly at a room temperature. So when people come to that level, that is where you become a very evolved society, and that is what is happening. The solar cells, the thermochemical, not thermochemical, but the fuel cells, etc., are all running at room temperature. Most of them are running at room temperature. So this is what we are evolving and following the nature. This is basically called the fire energy. Our designs are following this route, cell phones, etc. And societies are like Hugo jeans. This is a better structure. Because I'm giving you the philosophy of design and philosophy of innovation from rural. How many of you have heard about Prigogine? Chemistry guys? Prigogine? Prigogine got the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1977 for nonlinear thermodynamics. He showed that if you heat the water, you must have seen everything. When you heat the water in the jar or a container, what do you see? You see this beautiful convection curves. The hot water rises and the cold water comes back. If you look, you know, this is a very interesting thought exercise. If I give you physics, if I give you chemistry, and I tell you from basic principles, what will be the effect of the heat on this fuel, on this fluid? So all the laws will tell you that all of them vibrate, will vibrate tremendously with the temperature, and they all come to the heat then, which means they all vibrate. There is no such thing as a convection. So that's the basic laws of physics and chemistry. But that's why you want to know that. So I extended this, and this was a very unique concept. And I said that the societies are also like Prigogine structure, because depending upon the quality and the quantity of energy that comes from a society, or the society gets, it evolves. So it will evolve either into a decentralized society or a megacity-based society. All our societies are megacity-based societies because we use a very high intense energy structure, fossil fuels. If I have a decentralized energy source like biomass or solar, I will develop into a decentralized society. And this, to my mind, is the real future of the world for you engineers. How do we utilize these resources, which are called as a very minute resources, into good end products? Through the high technology, we evolve a very nice, holistic, and decentralized society. India is already a decentralized society, but we are all going towards the urbanization. So there is a great challenge for the engineers to reverse this trend and make this a very nice, holistic society. So what needs to be done? Improve the quality of life of rural poor 100. This should be the challenge. How, in fact, all of you also work towards that. When you go for a job, etc., this is what you are thinking. How will I have a nice house? How will I have all the decor, all the furniture, etc., so I have a very livable place? And then you talk about also how you have a good job. The same thing happens in the rural areas. The people in rural areas do not have a single neuron less than you and I have. They have the same aspirations. Now with this mobile and etc., they know what is possible. So this is what they are doing. How we attack the technology problem 100 times to make the life better. What do they need? They need, and this we have done the calculations. The planning commission has done a very simplified calculation, and this came from our work, you must read now in my book. They require close to 1200 kilowatt hour per year electricity. Electricity, we can talk and think about how to produce end use energy by using something else, not electricity. They require for fans, lights, refrigerator, and also 260 kilogram per year equivalent of LPG, because they also want the same type of quality of fuel as you and I have. Provide excellent rural livelihoods via high tech farming, and we talk about it. Get the best brains in the country to be engaged in rural development. Any one of you would have gone into agriculture? Why did you come to IIT? Why did you go to agriculture? How many of you are from agriculture background? Why did you go to agriculture? Exactly. Why? We'll talk about it. Anytime any person who has excelled in studies, they are asked by the parents to either become a doctor or engineer or go into some places in big cities, they are going into law because law is very powerful, they can make a lot of money and so many other things. Anybody who fails into everything will finally end up doing that. What means? So we start from there. When we have the lowest quality of brain in agriculture, where all of us eat food, look at the possibilities, look at the problems that this country is facing. In fact, you can ask me anything that you eat, and not a single seed comes from the Indian companies. They are all multinational, mostly based in Europe and America. Is this a happy state of things? And yet, we are capable of, because in 1990s, in fact, this is a digression, we are the largest user of edible oil in the world. We use maximum amount of oil in the world because we love fried things and etc. We import the same amount of edible oil as we import petroleum products. Look at the amount of, huge amount of outflow. And yet in 1990, when Rajiv Gandhi gave the call for making India self-sufficient in edible oil, he made India self-sufficient. From 1990, when the technology mission for oil seeds came, till 1994-95, we had become self-sufficient. And then suddenly came the very corrupt politicians and they said, what nonsense? We should import cheaper palm oil. And today, India is flooded with palm oil because people are making money. So we are capable of doing all these things. And the reason I'm telling you is because I'll show you later on why we require smart engineers in agriculture. India Inc. survives because of rural areas. That's where the food is produced. They help provide food. We cannot survive on nuts and bolts or software. India can only become a great nation when 60% of rural poor become middle class. That is the aim, and that should be the focus of all our activities. And I have written a chapter of roadmap for rural India in my book. If some of you have read, you can read, because that gives the basic philosophy on what we should be doing to make this country a great country. I want to show you what we have done. In some 100 tons and then agriculture. This is a land slope. I started working when I came back in 1981. There is no electricity. Necessity is the mother of invention, as I say. There is another word that says laziness is the mother of invention. Have you heard that? You heard it? Where?
Myself.
Well, we are on the same boat because I thought I coined that out. So when I came, there was no electricity, so I should read in the land. You must have seen the land. How many of you have read in the land? For how many hours and days and years? Huh? When you start reading, after some time it becomes very bad on the eyes. Eyes become very tired. And as a PhD from America, I said, what is this? And the sad part was my wife's family was involved in the largest lantern manufacturing of this country. Prabhat lanterns you must have seen, etc. They were manufactured by my wife's family. So I went to see the factory. And I looked at it and I saw that nothing had changed since 1870 when it was designed. It was exactly the same. Yes, they were using better machines to make it and so on, for better coating, etc. So I started thinking, what can be done to improve the quality of life, or quality of light from the The first thing I did was to find out the efficiency of these lanterns. So I collected all these lanterns. I did an efficiency measurement in 1984-85. And this became the benchmark of all the liquid fuel lighting that is quoted by the World Bank and so on. Because nobody had done that. Because nobody was interested. After Edison got the electric bulb, everybody thought it was a useless thing. But yet, majority of Indians still use that. So after we did that, then I started working on making better lanterns, and our UV lantern became very good for us. But then still it was a lantern. And as we were developing this, I suddenly found out that when we have this metal lantern, it produces a huge amount of heat. First of all, we measured the whole efficiency, etc., and we found out it was 1 to 2% efficient maximum for light output. 98 to 99% was simply going out of heat. So can we utilize it? And coming back to my philosophy, how do you utilize all the forces? So we developed a concept of a lamp scope. So this lamp scope has this metal lamp, which is equivalent to 200 watt bulb light, and the heat of it, we developed a very efficient steam cooker based upon steam pipe light, which is useful, which cooks for a family of five, including the bhakris and chapatis, and also boils 10 liters of water. And this kerosene is in this red cylinder. It lasts for 1 week, sometimes 10 days even. And all the system, that's where the engineering came, because we wanted to make this as good as an LPG. So with the flip of a valve, the woman opens it, puts the light, and becomes a second LPG. The beauty of this is that when you use lights, you use a very wonderful light, the combustion is complete. And some of you who are mechanical engineers will realize, when the combustion is complete, because without complete combustion, you will not get very high light. And when the combustion is complete, it is purely produces nothing else but carbon dioxide and water. So we have measured in a lot of measurements. And the particulate levels are much lower than the LPG. How many of you have used LPG? Everybody was using LPG. Have you looked at the burners? Do they produce only blue flame or yellow flame or red flame? Huh? What? That's what you mean. Have you seen? After some time, they all start producing yellow flame. All fuels are dirty. It is the combustion which makes it clean. Engineers should understand that. The moment when I talk, because this became a very big national news, huge write-up in Times of India, in TV, etc. And the first thing that the government said, kerosene, are you mad? We are getting out of kerosene. Because the whole basis of thinking that kerosene is a bad fuel, because this is all being fueled by the Western government, because they are vested interests. They want solar lamps. Solar lamps will not cook. They don't have any technology for cooking, because they still insist that we should use wood, maybe better chula, maybe smokeless chula. What is smokeless chula? A chula and chula. There is no such thing as a smokeless chula. Would you like to cook in a smokeless chula? What nonsense. Every woman of this country wants the very blue flame. Yes, if you develop a technology, it will give a fantastic blue flame. And some of you who are a little more knowledgeable about the combustion of a solid fuel will know that bringing a blue flame from a solid fuel is very difficult. You can do a better design if you're designing a rocket than designing a chula, which will give you a blue flame from a solid fuel. That's why liquid and solid fuels are the most appropriate fuel for engineering. So we attack this problem for dosing. We tested this in 25 different huts, which had no electricity. They loved it, they wanted it immediately. The cost appears a little high. Sorry, I didn't put the cost. The cost is around 10,000 rupees for the whole system. But see, the question is when something is very useful, the people themselves become very innovative. The animal said that we give you 30 rupees per day and we will own this after a year. Because we have supplied it all free. Initially, their biggest problem was getting kerosene, because kerosene is a controlled substance, and the PDS people, they sell it in back. So we had a very tough time, and we still are having a tough time. In fact, the government of Maharashtra has removed kerosene completely. So we developed this land store running on diesel. In fact, on diesel, it runs even better. It runs better than the Mercedes engine because of the fact that the combustion is so clean in this process that the outcome, because if you take the, we have the gas chromatograph signature, the signature shows only carbon dioxide and water. Why I'm showing you all this? Because I'm trying to tell you that a very sophisticated technology and thought goes in designing something as mundane as a cooking and lighting device for the room. Can you show the movie? Our movie, Man Manish. Sorry.
So, now everything vanished.
No.
I just want to show you just a 1 minute, 1.5 minute movie on all the thing. I said my movie man vanished. Huh? I'll use this time to drink some water. I should hurry up. It's getting little. But I can talk for hours because this is my junoon. This is my passion. And I hope if I can give this junoon to you a little bit, then it'll be much. And you know, these people, the biggest problem, have you seen solar lanterns? Have you played with it? Have you studied in it? Huh? I thought all of you, some of you work in rural areas, and this is a very big thing by the Western economies, etc., to push, especially Hillary Clinton is and Julia Roberts, they're all into this solar lantern business. Solar lantern is a device which provides around 600 lumens. What our lantern provides is around 3000 lumens. We're talking about 1/6. So it can show you where the snake is going. But if you start reading it, then there's a lot of problems. Not only that, even on all these lamps, they all produce blue light. Blue light is not very good for the eyes. Because if blue light was what was meant for the eyes, then sun would be producing blue light. Sun produces a spectrum which has very much yellow light. And our land stove, because it's a complete it's a high temperature incandescent process, so it produces a complete spectrum because we measured all the spectrum, and which has a very good yellow component. In fact, they are finding now that these LEDs are extremely harmful for retinas. And this is something they don't want to advertise, because of the fact that if they advertise, then this huge LED industry will go away. So now what they are doing is they are coating the LED lights with the powders which produces small amount of yellow. So it is quite easy on the eyes. So this is a. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. नहीं नहीं बंद कर दो दिस ऑल क्लोज इट दिस इज अ फिल्म दैट वाज मेड बाय माय डॉटर दिस इज द कंपोजिट ऑफ ऑल द हट्स दैट वी वर्क्ड इन सो वी टुक द फोटोग्राफ्स फ्रॉम डिफरेंट प्लेसेस एंड द इंटरेस्टिंग पार्ट इन दिस इज दैट डू यू मेक रोटीज गर्ल्स माइट बट बॉयज दे शुड मेक रोटीज हाँ You make? You made one roti in your life? Most of these women, you know, the poverty that I saw, in fact, all of you just spend time in their huts, then you'll realize these huts are so dark that during daytime also you require light. Because the whole evolution of huts came from the fact that they wanted to keep the heat away. So they have only one door, which is mostly open, a small window where the smoke from the chulas go. Otherwise, it's all thick mud walls, and it's very dark. Now, most of these people who are in these huts where we worked with, they are landless laborers. They all go out, they work during the daytime in the fields, and they come back and cook. Now, if you go and work in the sun for 7 hours, would you like to come in back and cook? And yet these women, they cook for the whole family, mostly sometimes five, maybe even six, but four and five. So what they do, and they don't have enough money, so they eat with mostly bread, bhakri. So they make very thick bhakri, because that means that they have to cook few bhakris. And then they can, so each person can have one bhakri and that's the end of meal. So they complained tremendously when we started giving them because, you know, the heat is not meant for making thick bhakris because that chula produces around 3 kilowatt because they continue putting in huge amount of wood and the tremendous amount of smoke comes out. So it took some time for us to tell them that this is a very clean and once they became well versed with that, then they could cook more thinner bhakris, because this is not meant for the old type cooking in terms of bhakri, but the cooking, but the other food, etc. And they became very innovative in cooking a lot of things. So this is a very interesting thing that we. So the challenges are quite a lot. When you produce this lamp, there's a huge amount of heat that comes out as radiation. I need to have a very high-tech heat-resistant glass, not heat-resistant, heat-reflecting glass. So that all the infrared simply remains inside so that all the energy goes for cooking. Then most of these people have cell phones. In fact, the fastest selling item in India are cell phones, in rural India, are cell phones and two-wheelers because they provide a niche and they are very useful. Now these people have cell phones. They have to go around 10 kilometers to charge those cell phones. I have quite a lot of heat source. Can I have a small thermoelectric element? Because cell phones don't require too much of energy. Can I have a thermoelectric element which I can attach to it and I can charge the cell phones? Because for you it is not there, it is a means of communication. For most of these poor people, cell phone is not only a means of communication, it's a means of entertainment also. They listen to the radio, they see the movies, no matter how small it is. And it has opened up a complete new world to them. So if we can have a charging system, that will be very useful. And that's a challenge for some of you. And then, we have, I'm talking with the government, but the government is very slow in that availability of diesel with a UID card for these poor people at a subsidized rate. And finally, we need a tremendous technology of converting agriculture residues into fuels like diesel or kerosene. And this technology exists. It is a lot of R&D is being done in Europe and America, and we need engineers and technologists like you to do it in India. Then I'll also tell you something very interesting that we did for cleaning water. This could also boil water, but if you didn't want to use kerosene, then this was a very good way. We filtered the dirty water through a 4-layer sari cloth, which most all the women wear. And then we heated this water in the solar tubes, and it completely made it free of coliform. We have a first-class microbiology lab. We tested this for 1.5 to 2 years, did all the microbiological testing, and we found it to be totally pure. The interesting part why we did this is that on even on an extremely cloudy day, when there is slight drizzling, you can reach 45 degrees Celsius. And 45 degrees Celsius for 3 hours can make it completely pure and free. So we are giving this technology. I have made this available free, and I have seen that this was a very good way. We filtered the dirty water through a 4-layer sari cloth, which most all the women wear. And then we heated this water in the solar tubes, and it completely made it free of coliform. We have a first-class microbiology lab. We tested this for 1.5 to 2 years, did all the microbiological testing, and we found it to be totally pure. The interesting part why we did this is that on even on an extremely cloudy day, when there is slight drizzling, you can reach 45 degrees Celsius. And 45 degrees Celsius for 3 hours can make it completely pure and free. So we are giving this technology. I have made this available free, and we are giving this to all over the country. And it's very easy and very simple and cheap. Oh, sorry, I keep on. So use a solar tubular water heaters. 99% of times water temperature is greater than 50 degrees Celsius. Hot water can also be used for producing ice for refrigerators. And this is a challenge for all of you. Because when the hot water comes sometimes at 80 degrees, 90 degrees Celsius, because the temperature in the solar system becomes very high, I have to cool it for drinking. Can I use that heat to produce ice? Because most of these poor people, they cook only once in the evening, and they eat the whole food, the food on the next day. If I can give small amount of ice in a nice ice box, it can become a very nice refrigerator. How do I convert this high temperature into ice is a challenge for a lot of you engineers. Will you take it? I have been talking, you know, I just gave, I was a chief guest at the Mechanical Engineering Symposium in IIT Bombay. I gave this challenge there, and I have yet to see a result. I have yet to see the feedback. And this is a real tragedy for this country, because we are looking at a very, very sophisticated system where through the absorption system or something else, we can produce ice from this. So challenges: low-cost solar power refrigeration, low-cost ATM for water and ice, so that once I produce ice, I can sell it, and efficient ice box as a refrigerator. Now I'll come to my rural livelihoods. 80% of rural population is involved in farming. 80% of farms in India are less than 2 hectares of size, very small farms. Farm productivity in India is the lowest in the world, almost 33% of the world's best. If we improve the productivity, we can not only feed India, but we can also feed the rest of the world. Farming is non-remunerative, and farmers' children do not want to farm. Farmers' suicide, and that's what your father said. And that's what a lot of farmers, because I get huge number of children from farming families who want to get a desk job. They don't want to do farming, because farming is a back-breaking job. Even if you are driving a tractor, have you driven a tractor? You're all certified people, huh? Drive a tractor. You'll find that even you have a tractor, it is so hard, because if you put a cut, and if the cut is not very nicely done, the tractor will rise up, it's very bumpy, and still you are sitting in the sun. So we are doing work with Mahindra. In fact, I'll show you, we are doing very interesting work in precision agriculture with Mahindra. So I gave the challenge to Mahindra engineers. I gave a big talk on the Mahindra engineers, and I said, design for me a nice tractor with a cabin where it is completely air conditioned, or something to cool, such that if I drive for 8 hours, I should not feel very stressed out. If you do that, then there will be a lot of people who like to drive that. Have you seen these JCBs, these big machines, the earth movers? Have you driven? I'm very curious. I drive all these. I get these people, I tell them to get down, I drive. It's a very tough job here. 4-5 gears back and forth, up and down. It's not an easy thing. Actually, they learn. But not only that, the amount of noise, and they all are open, still the heat, etc. So we create machines which are extremely stressful. And that is what the job of engineers is, how to make life easier for these people. Large areas of farmland are being sold to builders. In fact, the farmers will be the first one to sell the land because they get a lot of money. Precision farming for small farms can increase productivity and make farming glamorous. This is my new passion. I wrote an article on this 3 years ago, which became the best read article all over the world. It was published in New York daily and in all sort of magazines and etc. And hopefully it may have started a small revolution in this country of going for precision agriculture, where the Niti Aayog and others are looking at that. And we are already doing it by, I've gotten Mahindra, and we have tied up with Mahindra. I've given them around 3 to 4 acres of land in my institute, and I have told them that we'll use all their machinery that they have imported a lot of very sophisticated machinery, including their drones and etc., on how do we create a system by which the productivity of the farm increases drastically. And I'll show you what my dream is. Precise and timely input to crops, robots base. And that should excite you. You all are looking for robots, isn't it? All of you want to go into software and robots and etc. And that is what I am giving you a challenge, that tomorrow's farming will be a robot-based farming. 3D-based manufacturing in rural areas for that, and a great challenge for engineers and scientists. This is my dream for Indian farmer. He will read the paper. And today it is happening. It is not a science fiction or something. Large areas of Maharashtra are now under wheat cultivation. In the old times, just like in north, the wheat was cut by hand. Today, when the farmers, the wheat is ready, because wheat requires very little inputs. And you put fertilizer, water, and that's it. So the person calls this huge harvesters, which come from Punjab. There are also a lot of them are manufactured. He calls that harvester comes, and within a matter of hour or hour and a half, he takes care of the whole 1 acre plot of wheat, and he charges per acre, and that's the end. No labor, because the biggest problem that is happening, this is happening all over the world, there is no labor in farming. All the factories that are coming, people do not want to do any more farming. So if you see laborers in the field, they are mostly the family members. There are very, very few laborers now available. So this is what is the future. So he will just have to phone, okay, do my sowing, do my harvesting, do my weeding, etc. And this will be a thing which will come. So the challenges are to develop cheap drones. How many of you are working in drones? Drones were supposed to be for killing people. When I wrote my article 3.5 years ago, then people were very surprised that I was talking about drones for agriculture. Because drones allow a tremendous ability, the cameras. If I sense where the problem with water and where the problem with the disease is, I can take a timely action and my productivity increases drastically. That I cannot do by just standing. The drones allow me to hover, and 2 acres, 1.5 acres, which a common farm has today, allows small quadrupters and etc. to do that. And even a $300 drone can do some of these things. Then affordable and efficient drip irrigation. So we have started this work in our farm. We have a very sophisticated drip irrigation now with the Mahindras. We are getting some drones to look at this, some of these things. We'll have to develop the whole protocol of how to identify the insects, how to identify the stresses for the water. And we are looking for planting. Planting, they don't have the drones, the robots, but we have a very sophisticated now machinery for weed removers and hopefully for harvesters. And this is something which I have thrown as a challenge to the Mahindra engineers to develop these small machines. But more than that, you will be the future of Mahindra engineers. So do it. This is a tremendous ability for you to use your engineering in agriculture. And ultimately, the model is that no farmer can afford this, so it will be leasing companies. So he can just call, and per hour, per acre basis, he will give the money. Now, India produces 600 to 800 million tons of a year of agricultural residues. Mostly, they are burned in the fields. food is 25 to 40% of produce, rest are all residues. Look at the amount of energy that the farmer spends for getting nothing. No money to farmers from these residues, and potential of either producing 80,000 megawatt of electricity or 60 to 80% of India's diesel requirement. I am very proud to tell you that I am the principal author of the national policy on the biomass production, electricity production from biomass. We did the definitive study in 1990s, and the government of India took this in 1994-95, and all the biomass power plants, which are 120 or so in the country, they came from that policy. So this is possible. All over the world, there are a large number of power plants producing electricity from agriculture residues. So this is unheard of. Nari's Talikwa Energy Plan, so 10 to 15 megawatt biomass power plants, challenge to develop smart grids, and higher farm production means more residues, and energy from farming can be rupees 2 lakh crores per year in industry and bring in wealth for rural India. Now, when you do farming, you also require water issues. So increased farm productivity needs increased and efficient use of water. India uses around 16 to 20% of total rainfall. 65% of irrigated area uses groundwater resources are depleting, just like fossil fuels, and need to do more rainwater harvesting for agriculture, check dams and small private water utilities. There's a great challenge for the civil engineers, and I can give you an hour lecture on how we do that. The challenge is optimum size and number of check dams per taluka, and watershed technology and management as a part of undergraduate curriculum. In fact, I personally think that this should all be taught as a part of your undergraduate curriculum. Small amount of agriculture engineering, watershed development, then you will become better engineers. So challenge of engineers, develop household devices to remove drudgery, efficient lighting and cooking technology, clean water, efficient fans, maximum meter cube per watt. This is a great challenge. Most of the houses inside, you don't require reduction in temperature. Temperature inside the huts are quite all right. You just need to pull the air or push the air. And there's a great requirement, all these fans, they are very poorly designed. There's very hardly any design. They just throw the air. How do you utilize smaller amount of energy to push the maximum air requires a tremendous amount of thinking. There are a lot of natural systems in the oceans which do that, and so there is a need to mimic those things. Develop technologies for precision farming, autonomous small farms, machines, etc., electric and air-powered motorcycles. How many of you would like to work on electric motorcycles? I think the future of world, especially rural India, is electric motorbikes. Today, the motorbikes have come to such a level where you will not see the difference between electric motorbike and the regular motorbike. All these other motorbikes use fossil fuels, petrol, diesel, which cannot be grown. Electric motorbikes can run on electricity, produce there locally. And that is a great challenge. In fact, I have a dream that all the farm machinery should also run on fuels which come locally. And that is a challenge for engineers. And become technology managers. So all of you, a lot of you would like to become financial managers, right? Raise your hands. How many of you would like to go become financial managers? I want you to become technology managers. Steve Jobs was a great technology manager. He didn't do anything engineering, etc., but he was a manager, technology manager. He took up things. All great technologies which are coming from Silicon Valley are coming by people, driven by people who are technology managers. You don't need to invent. There are so many things available in all different areas. You just need to put together to solve your final problem. Like we did in our land store, we are looking at thermoelectric element, we are looking at something else, just putting it together. So these are Nari technologies. We developed ethanol from sweet sorghum. We developed the first solar-powered system in 87, producing ethanol from sweet sorghum. Then we developed a solar detoxification work also, because after distillation, there's a lot of foul-smelling effluent that comes out. We used solar energy. Then we looked at the gasification, because the whole Maharashtra, after harvesting, the farmers put the residues, they light the residues. We developed a half a megawatt gasifier, which is on the campus. And then our taluka plan. And then we were We feel very proud to be the pioneers in the electric cycle rickshaw and all the e-rickshaws that you see. There's a very interesting story. I can tell you, it's a long story, how I tried to introduce e-rickshaws on this campus in 2000. I said I'll donate 5 e-rickshaws to IIT Kanpur because I'm a very small person, very small institute, and yet the authorities to be did not take it. Because I said, at least you should run it, but we'll donate it. But anyway, this never happened. It's a long story. It was written up in Economic Times and etc. And we sold a lot of rickshaws in Europe and America. And now I come to my last, best brains for rural development. Need to get rural poverty in the DNA of small, smart kids. I want you to come and join me and work for a few months, year, whatever it is, and get into your brain what is poverty. We'll help rural areas when they become corporate honchos. Helping rural poor through technology is the best use of technology education. That's what you're all. Give 2 months of days per month, very small amount, 3% of your time for social work. Develop a genuine for society work. So I said, I need some engineers and interns. And mantra of India's development should be spirituality with high technology. Spirituality reduces greed and high tech helps in efficient use of resources. And finally, I'll end by telling you a small story. This is a story from our Puranas. You know Purana? So this is a story about a typical Indian sage and his disciples. So the sage asks his disciple, when does the night end? And the disciple says, at dawn, of course. The sage says, I know that. But when does the night end and the dawn begin? So the first disciple, who is from Kerala, he says, when the first glimmer of light across the sky reveals the fronds of the common trees, coconut trees, swaying in the breeze, that is when the night ends and the dawn begins. The sage says, no. So the second disciple, who is from Kashmir, he says, when the first streak of sunshine make the snow gleam white on the mountain tops of the Himalayas, that is when the night ends and dawn begins. The sage says, no, my sons, when two travelers from opposite ends of our land meet and embrace each other as brothers, and when they realize they sleep under the same sky, see the stars and dream the same dreams, that is when the night ends and dawn begins. And I feel that when bright engineers like you, who have ample opportunities, will light up the lives of less blessed rural population through technology and resources, then it will bring in the dawn of a new and happy India. This is a sense of giving back to society and is a romance of innovation. Thank you very much. These are some of the sites. You can look at it. Some sharp questions. Or you are bored. Yeah. Oh, very much. Yes, because if I do something, I would like to see what is the impact. CSR is a big rubbish. They love to write in their reports that we did a lot of CSR, but none of them do CSR. I work with Cummins, I work with Mahindra and Marico. They all are looking at the bottom line. It is my job as a technology manager to seduce them. They may get anything they want. If they can help what I'm trying to do, that's it. So with Cummins, we are trying to see if we can develop the stoves and run on large scale. Even our water purifier. With Mahindra's, we are trying to develop this. Sure, they will love to put it in the CSR. We did this much with the NARI. Let them do it. But on their own, they're not. This is the biggest tragedy. And since, you know, because I would like to have a lot of questions because I can explain. During Gandhiji's time, do you think that we were great people? They were all as crooks. Bajaj was as crook as is today. Birla was as crooked as they are today. What Gandhiji gave was a higher thinking. He appealed to their heart and they changed. Unfortunately today our corporate world, and some of you will join the corporate world, I hope you change it, they are least interested in any of these things. We talk a lot about Bill Gates and how crooked he was and this, etc. But look at the amount of charity they do. They have changed the whole process by the amount of money that they have given to erasing malaria and so many other things. Our corporates have also a huge amount of money. But they would like to build 25-story houses. They would like to, it's very tragic, you know, it's obscene. You can wear only one shirt and one pant at a time. So why do you want to have 500 shirts? You can live only in one house. In fact, the sad part is that they are not even living in that 25-story house. because there is no, there's because of vastu. What a tragedy in this country that we look at technology and we look at this nonsense. When we send the rocket to the Mars and Moon, we do puja of the rocket and Moon. I never saw Von Braun and others doing puja when the Saturn V rocket was going. This is very strange. And you as a young engineers and the future of this country, develop a, you know, I write a lot on spirituality. I do a lot of interaction of the old philosophical thought and the modern science. But I try to see where they did something wonderful so that it matches with the modern science. So this is what, so CSR is a big tamasha, but we try to do and try to engage them for our benefit. Yeah.
So
your
talk is
a
lot. Can you just have 2 minutes before we
take the question of the question? Yeah. Sure. Oh, you are the boss. Huh.
I want to introduce you about the rural technology action group. It works to develop cheap, effective and sustainable technology for solving issues related to rural areas. Just as Dr. Rajvanshi has worked on finding and implementing local suitable solutions for rural problems, so has RuTech. It is an open platform of technical institutes, grassroots NGOs, processors and manufacturers to fill gaps in rural technology. For now, they have focused on small-scale food processors and water treatment areas, developing low-cost effective and low-energy requiring technologies to improve conditions. Operational and IT Kanpur for last 3 years developing improved metallurgy of horseshoes and armor processing machines have been some of the success stories. For those who want to be a part of it and see how technology can change lives, they can join RuTech IIT Kanpur. Membership forms will be available after the session. And now we can continue with the session.
Yeah. Thanks for a very enlightening talk. And you talked a lot about putting technologies into farming, right? To improve the farmers'
crops and efficiency. But should we also not focus on alternate sources of income for these farmers? Are there opportunities like that in rural?
Yeah, that's why we cannot get any more labor.
Because are coming, so they are all going there. They are selling the land. They have never seen so much money. In fact, a very interesting thing happened. In Bombay, these bars, and now there are no more dancing girls and dancing bars. But this young journalist, he found a lot of new BMWs and Mercedes. So he was very surprised at why such so many BMWs and Mercedes have started coming. So he started asking, these are all the young sons of farmers who sold the land. This is what they are doing. The moment the money comes, huge amount of money, with no vivek or wisdom, this is how they splurge. And within very few years, they are again broke. So how do we really, this is a really tremendous challenge. So not only do we need to have a technology, but we need to change the mindset. So we need a lot of teachers. When I came back, there were no good schools in our place. I have 2 daughters, so we started our own school. So whichever class my daughter went, the school went. And now it is one of the best schools. It's a school in the cloud. We've got a huge fund from Tata's to change the curriculum of all the Zilla Parishad schools. My daughter, the younger daughter, now teaches in their school, and hopefully she'll run Passion, the Junoon. The one of the things that we try to teach there, how do we change the mindset? 6 hours they spend time in the school, 18 hours at home. All detoxification takes place. It's a great challenge. I don't have any answer, but this is all for all of us. And I think the only way to do that is first change yourself, and then things will start changing. Yeah, something.
We talked about additive manufacturing and process.
Yes. Yes.
I want to elaborate on that.
Okay. It's very interesting. In 1996, I visited a media lab in MIT because I go regularly, the same type of bhashan that I do here. I give lectures in America, trying to make them interested in. And there I saw this a small model they were developing. And I was very impressed because I am a great pujari of Mahatma Gandhi. And I could see that here was a system which, if fully developed, would for the first time bring in self-sufficiency in rural areas. Because I can use the materials, I can use energy, and I can produce whatever I want. And the technology is advanced so much now that you can do that. So small things, right now most of the technology is in the plastics, but more and more it is coming into metals also. And so once you have, see, for example, it's very difficult for me to get good lathe operators and etc. So if I have this machine and somebody even designs me in from IIT Kanpur, I just print it out. Print it out means I just get it manufactured. Yes, yes, yes. And you know, they have become so cheap. In fact, the National Science Foundation is a very big science foundation in America, which does a lot of engineering and et cetera. So the head of engineering is my classmate. So I was talking with him, and they are starting a very interesting program. In high school, they are putting this additive manufacturing or 3D printing in all schools. So when the kids, they make everything with the hand, they become interested in engineering. Otherwise, just like here, most of the students, they don't want to do engineering because that is not what the glamour is. That is not what Hollywood teaches them. Same here. So this is what is happening. Sure. Yes, very much. In most of the engineering colleges, most of the universities now in America, the whole libraries, one floor is now completely of additive manufacturing. You can just go, just like you used to do Xeroxing in the old times, you give your design and out comes a model. Yeah, yeah. Yep. See, that's what I'm saying, that the new thought has to go back and change the social milieu of the rural areas. Yes. That's what I said, that we are now looking at new machines for harvesting, new machines for planting, for improving the productivity through drip irrigations and etc. So this is all part of that. Yeah. So see, these machines will be owned by the company. So the venture funds, because there's no venture funds even in rural development, where is the question of the agriculture. There are venture funds only in IT. So I'm looking for venture funds so we can develop these technologies through that. Yeah. How do you know there's a red tape? Red tape is in everything. You go and get a license, you will get a red tape. If you are smart, you will manage the system. Not by giving bribe, but looking at a lot of other things. This is going to happen. There's no red tape. When I developed this policy, suddenly I got a call from the Prime Minister's office that this is fantastic, because there was a two-column write-up on this taluka thing. So we are setting up a big group. Would you like to come and help us? And the policy was made. Sure, there was a lot of red tape. Sure, there was a lot of things which happened later on which didn't happen of what I wanted. But it happened slowly. Janoon. What is that?
We need to some machinery or something. It cannot be straightforward use in the small farms of your country.
Have you done any farming? Go and do it. And I would like all of you to start from your hostel, start your kitchen gardens. If you make your own vegetables, grow your own vegetables organically without spraying, just learn. Do it. You wear Nike, do it. If you do it, you will become a much better person. I think in this country we just talk too much. If I had discussed all these things, and I don't think I would have done. I just came and did. And I don't think I have done anything great. Just small things. Do it. And I think it will be a great thing, because you know, in America and in Europe, all the students in the universities are given a patch of land to grow your own vegetables. And after, when they finish their classes, they go and work. One of the biggest problem in India is we don't work with our hands. And this is the best thing you can do. You start with your, with a small patch in your own hostel and produce vegetables. Then you will see everything. Because when you start doing it, then your smart brain, I hope you're smart, the smart brain will start interacting, will start thinking, what can I do? Can I produce a small machine? Because laziness is the, you know, is a, how the invention takes place. Good. So next time when I come back, I should see that you are producing a hari mirch. Produce a single hari mirch. It's a great challenge. Yeah. Before I take more, how many of you would like to come? I have come here for a selfish reason of having some interns for 5-6 months. I'll not give you anything, any money. I'll make you work like mad. I'll give you a free place to stay. So don't come with getting a big packet that a lot of you get when you go for internship. And I really, really mean, and you will learn a lot. Can you take a challenge? Or out of sight, out of mind, because I have seen this a lot. Yeah, you will take a challenge? Okay, so you have my email. Most welcome. Write to me any time, and I'll be delighted. Yeah, now the question. Which department are you in? So why don't you start a small solar hot water? Just see for yourself. That's what I'm saying.
Why isn't it so famous already?
That's what I'm saying, that you take a small thing, put it on the top of your hostel, and just see for yourself what it takes. And then you realize, because not only there are technological challenges, but there are also cost challenges. And there are also government, for example, 25% to 35% of all the electricity in Germany comes from renewable energy. Solar, wind, etc. Very few people know that 17% of the total energy in the United States comes from renewable energy, which also includes the hydro and etc. These countries are taking it up on a very large scale. You should, if you are, because see, today internet provides you with all the knowledge. Go into the internet, find out that why solar is not taking place. There are a large number of articles, including my article, which came many years ago. Look at, because there are so many things which are technological and social and cost-wise. So that's the reason. But there is no reason why we should not have solar energy, because we have so much. It's a combination. Mostly the cost reason. Initially, Government of India gave subsidy when you put the solar water heater. They've removed subsidy. the people who will supply you solar water generator, they used to get the subsidy from government. It took them 2 years to get the subsidy, so they stopped doing it. So many, in a corrupt society, a lot of things happen. Yeah. They can read all that in the book.
It'd be a good idea to take you with you and get as much as you want from it, because of his family belongs to Lucknow, and he belongs to a family of freedom fighters, and very deeply involved in the freedom movement of the time. So he has a lot of things to give to you and to share with you.
No, no, it is all right. It is all right.
You also should take him to your hospital.
Yeah.
He is one of your own.
So more sharp questions. Yeah. Please go to that article and you will get all the answers, because there's a lot of things which were thought about that. Yeah. Huh? After that, Gautam Buddha was asked, what happens after death? What happens to our memories? What happens to the world? How is it formed? He said, first live a good life. These things will come. Will you live for 100 years to find out what happened to the solar panels? Why are you concerned about the panels after 100 years? You first use the solar energy and then see what happens. Why are you concerned? Well, I just don't understand. How many of the technologies will last for 100 years, including your body? Sure, Gandhi said that you can last for 125 years, and there are rishis and munis which say that they last for 400 years. But why? What is the use of setting up a power plant? Its life is only 25 years. So you should stop producing power, you should stop putting power plants. We have option. A lot of options, solar cells, all these options.
So,
yes.
So, you have been working for a long time period of time in implementing the technological solution to the user menaces or problems. So, all this while when you are working with the rural people, have you had any kind of experience where people are actually resisting the technological solution?
Sure.
Have been on the people you are working with, and what are the social changes you have observed all this time?
So So the whole talk was romance of innovation. I'm a romantic person. I'm not a social reformer. Gandhi was a social reformer. So many other people, Baba Amte, etc. We saw a lot of resistance. Anything, if I give you a new mobile, you will resist. Won't you? Because you're so used to one system that you'll resist. If you are using Android, if I give you Apple, you'll resist. So why should the people in the rural areas are different than you? So this is always is a human psychology. When they start seeing, when you start seeing that Apple is better as compared to Android, you start using Apple. Same thing happens. And the second question was? I did all these things for my own benefit. Social changes were basically the bonus. For example, do you eat safola oil? You have heard about safola oil. That comes from a variety Nari NH1. So 6,000 to 7,000 acres in this country are grown under our varieties. So that is a change. And so many other things that we did, they have done something. My wife comes from Maharashtra. You go where your wife takes you. That's the Indian philosophy. Yeah. We are talking now philosophy. So I think we should come to the guest house and we'll talk about it. Any more questions? Yeah, last question. Okay. Yeah, I get the gist of what you're trying to say. I'll discuss this. The reason why I'm stopping him, you see, internet provides a fantastic amount of knowledge. Lot of questions that lot of people you are asking comes from the ignorance of not looking at internet. If I want, you know, I do a lot of research now. I'm a technologist, but I do a lot of research on brain research now, because through my spirituality, I have become very interested in the brain. How the thought process takes place, how, and I've written books on that. It is very easy. I asked there's a very famous brain research institute, and I was very interested in the synapse. Synapse is where the knowledge, the information from one neuron goes to another through the chemical process. So I called up one of the top scientists in the brain research institute, and I said, what happens in the synapse? What are the things? So he asked me, he said, are you a brain researcher? I said, no. He said, why are you asking such a stupid question? That was the end of it. So I go to internet, and there's a huge amount of information available. And you become better. Because a lot of the questions that you're asking, they're very basic, simple things which you can find a lot. Because these are issues which have been discussed for years and years. What is the basis why the Indian farming is so backward, so many things. And there are very nice research papers and books, and they are all open in the internet, available. Even take a lot of the articles that I wrote, and then you'll see, and then you'll find out what are the problems. And then once you start looking at that, you become much more knowledgeable, and then you'll start looking at why this is happening, what is happening. But we can discuss this in the guest house. Okay, thank you very much. It was lovely. And as Dr. Vyas said, you are most welcome. And we can continue this discussion.
What is that?
I'm requesting Dr. Vyas to come.
No, but are you giving anything to me?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
I have